ॐ सदा शिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ॐ मौनव्याख्याप्रकटितपरब्रह्मतत्त्वं युवानं वर्षिष्ठान्ते वसदृशिगणैरावृतं ब्रह्मनिष्ठैः आचार्येन्द्रं करकलितचिन्मुद्रमानन्दरूपम् स्वात्मा रामं मुदितवदनं दक्षिणामूर्तिमीडे वटविटपि समीपे भूमिभागे निषण्णं सकलमुनिजनानां ज्ञानदातारमारात् त्रिभुवनगुरुमीशं दक्षिणामूर्तिदेवं जननमरणदुःखच्छेददक्षं नमामि चित्रं वटतरोर्मूले वृद्धा शिष्या गुरुर्युवा गुरोस्तु मौनं व्याख्यानं शिष्यास्तु छिन्न संशयाः निधये सर्वविद्यानां भिषजे भवरोगिणां गुरवे सर्वलोकानां दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः ॐ नमः प्रणवार्थाय शुद्धज्ञानैकमूर्तये निर्मलाय प्रशान्ताय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः चिद्घनाय महेशाय वटमूलनिवासिने सच्चिदानन्दरूपाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः ईश्वरो गुरुरात्मेति मूर्तिभेदविभागिने व्योमवद्व्याप्तदेहाय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः नानाच्छिद्रघटोदरस्थितमहादीपप्रभाभास्वरं ज्ञानं यस्य तु चक्षुराधिकरणद्वारा बहिःस्पन्दते जानामीति तमेव भान्तमनुभात्येतत्समस्तं जगत् तस्मै श्रीगुरुमूर्तये नम इदं श्रीदक्षिणामूर्तये. So we were looking at this fourth verse, and we have also seen the commentary of Sureshvara. So Sureshvara introduces this verse saying that there is still a doubt whether the Astitvam and the Prakashatvam, which is there in different objects, correct? Different objects are existing and they are revealed. Now these two qualities are these two, what do we say about it? These two aspects of any object, is it intrinsic to them or is it coming from Ishvara, somebody else? Now all other, mostly Nayayikas, there are a lot of materialists who say that objects exist by themselves. Swataha, swataha santaha, swataha prakashante means what? They are self-existent and self-revealing. But Vedantins are very clear, there is only one self-existent and self-revealing subject, you have to say, not even object, okay, which is only yourself. Self alone is self-revealing and self-existent. Everything else is only shining after this self, okay. So it is all borrowed existence, and also their the fact that they are getting revealed is only because of they are lighted up by this consciousness. So things which we think are existing and which are getting revealed really do not have existence and the ability to be revealed by themselves. But still this doubt is there. Really, did Ishvara enter this world and because of that only all these objects are all really existing and shining? Now that answer only is given by this particular verse. Then he goes on to explain this, why it is not possible for the objects themselves to be self-existent or self-revealing, because if you say that they are conscious independently, then, and also they can be revealed by themselves, means then all the time all the objects have to be revealed to everybody, correct? Then everybody will become sarvajnaha, all knowing. But that is not the case. Or if the revelation itself is left to the objects themselves, they may not reveal themselves also, correct? or everybody will be like in sleep. So there is a possibility that everybody will become all knowing or everybody will become totally ignorant. So like that, impossible situations will come. It won't be like some people know something and some people do not know something. So how are we going to account for this? This can be accounted for only by saying that there is ignorance, and that ignorance is destroyed only when a certain vritti is formed. Okay, certain modification of your mind is formed, because the mind has to take the form of the object, and when the mind takes the form of the object, okay, at that time that ignorance of that object is destroyed and the object gets revealed. Now even for this, the mind itself is not aware or conscious by itself. That's what is another very important thing. Mind also is equally jada, but it is a very refined jada, we have to say. Correct? It is sukshma sharira. So it has the capability to manifest consciousness. That's why consciousness alone reveals. And there is only one conscious being, which is yourself. And the analogy also given is like that, correct? Our thinking is that there are many conscious or sentient beings. But many sentient beings are having many minds, which is fine. They are all having many sukshma sharira, antakarana, we can say, correct? Sukshma sharira means subtle body. Or antakarana means internal organ, we are saying. So there are many bodies, physical bodies, with many subtle bodies and internal organs. That doesn't mean all of them are sentient or conscious by themselves. They are only a means to manifest this one consciousness. Correct? So this one consciousness is appearing there. Okay, that's what the appearance of the consciousness we call chidabhasa. Sometimes you may hear the term chidabhasa. Abhasa means what? Or chit pratibimba also people use. See, there is a pratibimba vada, abhasa vada, and all that. We don't have to get into all this. Sometimes people get into all these analogies too much. If you start analyzing the analogies too much, any analogy will not 100% fit into what we are trying to reveal. So you will get into confusion. But the relevant part we have to understand. The idea is that consciousness by itself is not a karta or bhokta. It cannot undergo any change. It cannot do any action also. Because Shruti is very clear in the way it is revealing Chaitanya. So this Chaitanya is Satyam Jnanam Anantam. That being the case, and it is Nirvikara, Nirvikalpa, all this, so many words are used to convey that this consciousness is the unchanging reality and it does not undergo any activities or changes. It is not subjected to space-time. All these things are very clearly revealed. Then, but we are saying consciousness appears. Consciousness alone goes through the mind and through the nadis and through the indriyas and all that, we talk about it, correct? And then the mind takes the form of the object, means that also we are saying the consciousness which is conditioned by that state of mind, correct? The consciousness which is conditioned by a particular state of mind is called vritti chaitanyam, or vritti upahita chaitanyam we say. The consciousness which is conditioned by the state of mind is called vritti upahita chaitanyam. That vritti upahita chaitanyam and the vishaya chaitanyam also we say, the consciousness conditioned by the object. Because for us, consciousness alone is the one reality, one and only non-dual reality. Ekameva advitiyam. Objects are also manifestation of consciousness only. The subject, the knower, who is actually characterized by the internal organ antakarana as a whole is also a manifestation of consciousness, and a particular state of mind where the mind takes the form of the object, that is what we call manovritti. That also is nothing but a manifestation of consciousness only. So the consciousness which is conditioned by the object and the consciousness which is conditioned by the state of mind have to be one and the same, we say. Then only pratyaksha jnanam takes place, sense perception takes place. For that, mind itself has to go out, we say, through the indriya. Okay, the mind which is actually, we have to say, energized or impelled by this consciousness goes out through the indriya and takes the form of the object. That is what, how we describe how sense perception takes place, pratyaksha. It is even like we say water. You release water from a big reservoir. Then what? It goes out through a small opening. It goes out through different channels, and then finally it occupies a particular field, correct? When it occupies that field, it takes the shape of that field itself. If the field is square, that water also fills up that square. If the field is circular, the water fills up the circular or cylindrical, whatever, space. So this is the kind of analogy which is given. Similarly, mind also goes out. And all these dwaras, the openings, are the indriyas. Okay? And that is what is shown by the analogy in this verse also. In the verse we say, Nana Chidra Ghatodara Sthita Mahadeepa Prabha Bhaswaram. Means what? Nana Chidra means in the pot, Ghata is there. In that, there are many holes. Okay? And within that, there is a Mahadeepa is there. There is a great light. And then what? That light is now going out through all these different holes. So the holes are nothing but the indriyas which are there in different sukshma shariras. There is only one consciousness. And it is manifesting through all these different holes. And then it goes out and also lights up all the objects which are there outside. That is the analogy given here. You understand? Sureshvara himself is going to give one more analogy here in this context. See if we came up to that, I think. He gave another analogy. Sureshvara gave the analogy of a mirror also. Okay, what is the analogy here? The mirror has a shining side, and mirror also has a back side where they have coated it with some kind of a rasa, we call it, correct? In Sanskritism, it is called rasa. Or in Tamil also, or in English, we say some kind of chemical is coated there. Some coating is there, correct? That only makes the mirror reflect. So now Sureshvara is comparing the reflecting side to the buddhi and mind and all that, okay, of the sukshma sharira. And the non-reflecting coating side, Sureshvara is saying, is the prana. Okay, so there is a sukshma sharira itself. If you take the subtle body, it has both prana and manas. Now without prana, in fact, nothing can happen. The body itself, you will lose the life in the body, correct? There won't be any functioning of the body itself. Similarly, without the coating, even though the glass is there, the glass cannot reflect properly. So the coating is necessary. Similarly, prana has to be there, and prana has to be functioning correctly. Then only mind also functions. That is why if you want to have certain mastery over your mind, what do we say? Do pranayama. See, or prana vikshanam. Even if you are watching your breath, automatically your mind also will calm down. Okay, if you are able to master your breath, prana, and along with that you can also master your mind, because they are intimately connected. Breathing and your thinking That's why even when you are very anxious, they ask you to take a deep breath and all that, so that you can calm down. So there is a connection. So there is a, that's why karmendriya and jnanendriya both are part of your sukshma sharira, the subtle body, the organs of action and sense organs, both are part of your subtle body, and they are all part of the same subtle body. So one aspect of the subtle body is the mind and all that, which is what appears sentient. The other aspect is the prana, which is what makes you active, which makes you do things and all that. So he is comparing, there is a kriya shakti, jnana shakti in the antakarana, and they are compared to the shining side and the coating side of the mirror. And what happens on the shining side, the actual bimba is our consciousness, okay, our Ishvara. The real image, the real object is the consciousness, which is getting reflected on the shining side, means which is getting manifested in your antakarana as chidabhasa. So chidabhasa, we can take it as an appearance or a distorted appearance of consciousness or manifestation of consciousness. If you are not comfortable with reflection, it is the appearance of consciousness because of the sattva guna pradhana in the manas. It is able to manifest the consciousness, okay, because of the rajoguna pradhana of the prana. The same consciousness is manifest as activity there, life and action, everything is part of prana. So the buddhi is able to manifest this consciousness. That's why we think we are able to know. Of course, without the backing of the mind, no knowledge takes place. And many people even think that mind itself has the capability to know. But mind does not have the capability to know by itself. Okay, it is like the hot iron burning something. Hot iron burns something, that is correct. But the burning, that quality of burning or the ability to burn does not belong to the iron. It still belongs to the fire which is manifesting in the iron, correct? Similarly, mind is able to manifest this consciousness because it is subtle enough. It is sattva guna pradhana is there. Sattva guna is predominant in the mind. So mind itself is still jada only, but it is a subtle jada, okay, and it is able to manifest this consciousness, and consciousness alone is the one which is revealing all the objects. That's what we have to understand. And because the mind is able to manifest this consciousness, it is able to grasp the objects also. The objects are revealed. So somebody can say, I know this is part and I know this part, correct? Both takes place at the same time for us. Okay. So, and then all the sense organs also are connected to your mind or the antakarana, the internal organs, because each sense organ has a field or different types of objects which it is revealing to us, correct? They have a unique field of revelation. Eyes are revealing color, ears are revealing sound, nose is revealing to you the smell, like that. Each of them is revealing something, and so the mind has to go through this sense organ and take the form of the object, and then only whatever it is to be revealed is revealed. But how does the mind go through the indriya and all that? So what is the mechanism there? Now that is what he is going to talk about from the 10th verse up to 9. I think we covered already. So what is this 10th verse? He says, Ratanga nemi valaye keelita iva keelakaha nadyaha antakarane syuta jalasamsyuta sutravate. See, the nadis. In fact, we have this concept of nadi. whether we can even take them to be really physical things also is a question mark. But some people say nadi means blood vessel. Some people talk about neurons, okay, or nerves. Nerves are the nadi, really. In fact, from the description which is given, it seems more often that it can be a nerve, okay? Even you can see that how Sureshvara is describing these nadis. It looks like it is all nerves. So physically you can take them as nerves, or we can say the nadis are still subtle things which are manifesting through the nerves also. That way also we can consider taking them to be subtle. So there are many nadis. In fact, Kathopanishad itself is talking about nadis. So it is not that it is not part of the regular Vedanta. So nadyaha antakarane syutaha jala samsyuta sutravati means what? He is giving an analogy here. He says you have the net, correct, with which you catch fish and all that. There, that net is actually made up of how they make it with threads, correct? They tie the thread in the form of a net. That is what is called jala. So this net or network, we have to say. So similarly, nadis are also like that. They are the network within the in the sukshma sharira. Okay, they make up the network through which mind is going out, and again it goes out through the indriyas. So indriyas are there at one end, the antakarana mind is there, buddhi mind is there, and they both have to be connected by some network, correct? That network is the nadis. Okay, so nadis form that network or the net. Similar also, he is giving another analogy also. Rathanga nemi valaye keelita iva keelakaha. Rathanga nemi means what? See, the chariot is there. In that you have the wheel. Now, the wheel has a valaya means what? The wheel has an outer ring or a rim, correct? Outer rim of the wheel is called nemi. And then there is a central part, it is called nabhi. So from the nabhi you have all these spokes going out, correct? So that is the keelakaha. Iva keelitaha means the nadis are like the spokes. The central part is like your mind, and the rim is like your indriyas we have to take. So it is again another analogy is giving. So it is like the nadis are the spokes which are connecting the antakarana with the indriyas, and through that it goes out. Okay, so like this two analogies are given here, the net and the hub and spoke analogy, both are given. So like this, nadis are there. Then he goes on to now explain all the names of the nadi and all that, and even chakras, kundalini, so many things are coming. We'll see all that. Interesting. So he says, tabistu golakantabihi prasarpanti pulingavat karanani samastani yathasvam vishayam prati. So Golakanta bihi prasarpanti. See, these nadis, tabihi to Golakanta bihi means what? See, in the physical body also, we identify the sense organs with certain physical organs, correct? The physical eye is there, then nose is there. Like this, tongue is there, the organ of speech, mouth and tongue. Ears are there. They are all called golaka. The physical organ is called golaka, and the subtle organ, the actual sense organ, is manifesting through that. The nadis themselves are going up to these golakas in the body, okay, they are going up to that, okay. And then all these indriyas, so karanani samastani, all the indriyas and the mind also we have to take here, they go towards their object. Svam vishayam prati yatha spulingavat prasarpanti means what? Karanani prasarpanti means all this, the mind along with all these indriyas, they go towards, okay, or they, we have to say they actually go, means here it is even more than that, they are flowing forcefully as though you open a dam and the water gushes out, correct? They are gushing out towards their own vishayas, like even spark, he is saying. Spulingavata means it is like a spark, through the nadi only they gush out towards their objects, each indriya, and the nadi itself is there till the golaka, and then out it goes, okay, through the nadi. That's why nadis themselves also are like cubes, that's how they describe, because through them only all this, they are a network through which mind is flowing out and the indriyas also are flowing out through towards the their own objects. That is the idea here. And spark and all they are talking about. So even in modern science we say that nerves are all communicating through electrical signals, correct? So through that, so it is pulling the vate is saying here. Sureshvara is saying it is like sparks are gushing out, are going out. So that is the analogy they are giving. So it is more like nadis can be considered as nerves, I think. And now he is explaining exactly how many nadis are there, from where they come and all that. So he says, Dehasya madhyamam sthanam mooladharai tiryate budattu dvayangulad urdhvam medhrattu dvayangulad adaha. So Dehasya madhyamam sthanam, in the middle of one's body there is a mooladhara, is there Muladhara chakra and all we talk about, correct? There are 7 chakras in the body, etc. So Muladhara, it is called Muladhara, iti iryate. And where is it exactly? He says, budattu dvangulam, dvangulad urdhvam. So it is 2, angula here can be, in, it cannot be inch, I think. It will be too much. So angula is some particular metric, okay, it is a unit of measurement. Normally angula we are nowadays using it in the meaning of inch, modern inch, but I don't think it is exactly an inch. So he says 2 angulas up from the anal cavity, budat, and medratu dvangulat adaha, from the reproductive organ it is 2 angulas down, from the anal cavity it is 2 angulas up. That is where Muladhara is situated, okay, that's where Muladhara is there. And then further he is explaining how this Muladhara is, the Muladhara chakra. So he says trikonaha adho mukagrascha, so it is like a triangle, and the top portion of the triangle, correct, the that is actually the sharp angle is down, facing down, it is like a inverted triangle, okay. Trikonaha adho mukagrascha, the agra, the sharp portion is facing down, so it is an inverted triangle. And then he says kanyaka yoni sannibaha, so it is like the reproductive organ of a kanya, of a woman. It is like that. It is like a inverted triangle. That is the idea. And then he says, yatra kundalini nama parashaktihi pratishthita. So that is where this parashakti, the parashakti herself is manifest there, we have to take. Or Parashakti can be taken generally, like a great Shakti power called Kundalini. Kundalini is there. Okay, it is Pratishthita. Kundalini is residing there. Kundalini it is called because it is like a coiled spring and all we say. The Kundal. Kundala means again a coil, something circular. So this Shakti is like a coiled spring. Means that means we are not actually using this Shakti at all. It is there. The Shakti is not kindled. This power is not tapped. It is there in everybody in this Muladhara Chakra. Kundalini Nama Parashakti is there. This great force, this great power called Kundalini is there in this chakra, Muladhara Chakra. It is there. And then what? And this further is explaining this Kundalini only. Prana Agni Binduna Danam Savitri Sa Saraswati Muladhara Agrakonastha Sushumna Brahmarandragha. So Prana Agni Binduna Danam Savitri means what? Prana, of course, all the whatever Pancha Prana, it is there. That's what keeps your body active. Then the Jatara Agni. Agni here means the digestive fire, because whatever you eat is digested, and that is looked upon as a fire, because anything you put into the fire also it digests, correct, and produces ash. Similarly, whatever you eat you are able to digest, that is looked upon as a fire. In fact, Bhagavan says aham vaishvanaro bhutva praninam deham ashritah. So I am the one who is sitting as the fire in your body called Vaishvanara, Jathara Agni. So that Agni also is actually impelled by this. Savitri means here the impeller, or the one who gives them the josh, okay, the power, the force. The impeller, Savitri. This Kundalini only is making your prana active in your body. And also it is also one which actually keeps this fire in your stomach active so that you can digest anything. And Bindu. Bindu means it is unmanifest. Sound is called Bindu. And Nada is the actual manifest sound. So all this, your ability to speak also is all because of this Kundalini only. Kundalini is the one which is actually controlling all these things, which is impelling, which is giving the force, which is the force behind all these things in your body. And that Kundalini only is the Saraswati. That's what the Kundalini only is the one which makes you speak also. It is the one which is flowing through your body, like that also we can take on making you active. And where is it? Okay, now this is about Kundalini. Kundalini is Pratishta in this Muladhara Chakra, fine. Then what else? Muladhara Agra Konastha. See, the Muladhara is like an inverted triangle. Then from that edge of that inverted triangle, that is the Kona, correct? In the Muladhara, from that edge of that inverted triangle, there is a Nadi called Sushumna. Sushumna starts from there, right from the end of that inverted triangle, from that edge, and goes up till where? Brahmarandhra is the point on your head, on your skull, on the top of your skull. One small point will be there which is soft. I think the skull itself is slightly, for children you can even feel it. It will be soft. As you grow up, I think maybe it actually closes up, the bone also closes up, but still one part on your skull, if you just feel it, it will be soft, right at the top of your head. That is the Brahmarandhra. So up to that Brahmarandhra, the Sushumna Nadi is going from the Muladhara's edge to the Brahmarandhra. Brahmarandhra is that part on your skull where you have a soft portion. Okay, so right at the top of your head, up to that this Sushumna Nadi is going. Brahma Rantra Ga. Ga means it goes up to that point. Correct? Then what? Mooler Dakshinavam Shabha Shadadhara Samanvita Tatparshvakona Yor Jate Dve Ida Pingale Sthite. Okay, so now Mule Ardha Chinna Vamshabha means what? See, at this Sushumna Nadi itself, I told you, correct? Nadi is like a tube. So they are saying, that's what he is explaining here. At the end, at the Kona, correct? In the Mooladhara, the Sushumna is like this. If you cut the bamboo, correct? You can see that how it is like a tube, correct? And you can cut it also. One side of it, you can just cut it and you can make it sharp. So the Sushumna is like that, it seems. Wherever it starts in the Mooladhara, it is like a bamboo, okay? Which is, a part of it is cut, half portion of it is cut. So that it is like a channel, essentially. And it is Shadadhara Samanvita. The Sushumna Nadi, while it is going up, there are six chakras or adharas, okay, apart from the Mooladhara. So we say that the reproductive organ, the nabhi is there, correct? Right on your stomach, then your heart, then your throat, kantha, then the in between your eyes. So like this, all these chakras we talk about. Different places, Shadadhara, including the Mooladhara, six are there. And then finally we talk about Sahasrara and all that. That is different. So this Sushumna goes through these six Adharas or chakras we have to take. And there are names also for all these things. Ajna Chakra, Manipura, like that. There are names are there. These six chakras are there. And then what? The Sushumna is going through all this up to the Brahmarandra. And then Tat Parshva Konayor Jate Dve Ida Pingale Sthite. So now, on both sides of this Sushumna, on the north and the south side, we can say, or the left and the right side, what are they? Again, two more edges are there, correct? Because the Mooladhara itself is like a trikona. In the middle only this Sushumna is going. Then from the other two edges, the Ida and Pingala are going. Okay. So this Ida and Pingala also are going. So Dve Ide Ida Pingale Sthite. So they are starting from that. The other two edges of that inverted triangle, and though they go along with this Sushumna, and all these three nadis together, they are called Nadi Chakra. So Nadi Chakra miti prahuhu tasman nadya samudgataha gandhari hasti jikvacha nayanantam pradhavataha. Nadi Chakrena Samsyute Nasikantam Ubhegate. So these three are called Nadi Chakram. This Sushumna, Ida, Pingala together, they are the Nadi Chakram. And from them only, Tasmat Nadiha Samudgataha, other Nadis are actually coming out from them. So it is like your spinal cord, also a modern physiology also talks about spinal cord and nerves coming out of spinal cord and all that, correct? Something like this, already our rishis are also talking about nadis and Ida and Pingala and all going up from the Mooladhara to the Brahmarandhra. And you can see all the nadis are all, they are spreading out from this Nadi Chakram. And And in that, again, he is giving some names and all that, particularly with reference to the Indriyas. Because Sureshvara is interested to show you that the Antakarana is connected to the Indriyas through the Nadi only. And the Antakarana and the Indriyas flow through the Nadi towards their object and then take the form of that object. And that's how knowledge takes place and all that. So the Nana Chidra Ghatodara Sthita Maha Deepa Prabha Bhaswaram. When we say the rays of that Deepa go through this, through the Chidra, the different holes and all that, correct? Now, accordingly, he is now explaining all these things, how it is exactly happening. So he says, Gandhari Hasti Jihvacha Nayanantam Pradhavataha. See, there is a Gandhari and Hasti Jihva, like these two nadis are there. Actually, when they are excited, they go up to, they run, or Pradhavataha, he says, up to your eyes. But otherwise, what? Nadi Chakrena Samsyute, from the Nadi Chakra, they go up to your nose, but when they are excited, I think they actually jump up to your eyes, or they connect your eyes also. So the nose and the eyes are connected by this Gandhari and Hasti Jihva. These are the two nadis. Then Nabhi Mandala Mashritya Kukutam Kukuta Andamiva Stitam. Then he comes to the Nabhi. Okay. So the Nabhi is where you are connected with your mother, correct? During when you were a fetus. That's how you got your life also, I think. That's how you lived when you were in the womb. So that is the Nabhi. So that is why even today the Nabhi has a special significance even in Ayurveda and all that. Many times even for some problems, they will say you put oil around every day around your Nabhi, correct? So over your stomach, there in that cavity or around that cavity, you put some oil and all that, it is supposed to help you. Even as a general health tip also, people say, even our ancestors, even today, they will say that you put some velakennai and all that, this castor oil. Every day also you can put around your Nabhi a little bit. It is supposed to help you. It may give you in general health. Okay. But that is where all this, in that Nabhi Mandalam, Kukuta Andamiva Stitam, he says. It is like the, like an egg. Egg of a hen. So, there it is there, all this Nadi. It is like the, that is where a lot of nadis are there, it seems, in the right at the middle of your stomach, where the Nadi Chakra also, these three things are going. There are a bunch of nadis which are like the egg of a hen. Okay. And from there only all this lot of nadis are again spreading out. Prahus Tasman Nadiyaha Samudgataha. So from there, from your Nabhi Mandala and around the Nadi Chakra there are nadis spreading out, and at that place itself, it is like a lot of nadis are there, and it looks like the egg of a hen, Kukuta Andamivastitam, and from there it is all spreading out, Samudgataha, Tasman Nadiyaha, Samudgataha. And what are those things? Again, he says, Pusha cha alam bhusha. Okay, Pusha and alam bhusha. Nadi. Karna dvayam upashrite. Okay, now see, we already talked about nose and eyes, correct? Two nadis he gave. What are those? He told that Gandhari and Hasti Jihva go up to your nose and then even up to your eyes. Then here he is talking about ears now. Karna dvayam upashrite. What are the Pusha and Alam Bhusha are the nadis which go up to your karna, the two ears. Karna dvayam upashrite. And then what? Nadi shuklahvaya tasmat bhru madhyam upasarpate. From the same, from your nabhi only, another nadi called shukla. Okay, Shukla Khvaya means it is what is called as Shukla, the nadi called Shukla. From there only, from your nabhi, it goes up to the middle of your eyes, Brumadhyam Upasarpati. And then what else? Sarasvatyahvaya nadi jihvanta vak prasarini. Then there is a nadi called Saraswati. The name of the nadi itself is Saraswati. And that goes up to your tongue, jihvanta. And that is the one vak prasarini. That is the one which manifests speech or broadcast. Prasaranam means nowadays it is called, they are using in the meaning of broadcasting, correct? Means the speech is also coming out through your tongue because of this nadi called Saraswati. There is a nadi called Saraswati, which is the one through which you get your speech also. Okay. And we have to take, since it is jikvanta, taste also is through that nadi maybe. Or for that he is giving another. So he says, nadi vishvodari nama bhunte nam sa chaturvidham. Okay, so there is another nadi. Not only the nadis are connecting the antakarana with the jnanendriya, but even karmendriya also, and food. So there is a nadi called Vishwodari. Udari means it is in the stomach, correct? Udaram means stomach. And so this nadi is called Vishwodari. And this is the one which is responsible for digesting all the food you are eating. Okay, bhunte annam sa chaturvidam. The annam is four types. The food you eat, this is there in Bhagavad Gita also, in fact, correct? Aham vaishvanaro bhutva praninam deham ashritaha pranapana samayuktaha pachamyannam chaturvidham. So Bhagavan says, I am the one who is eating these four types of food, sitting as the vaishvanara agni. And there Bhashyakara says, what is these four types of food? He says, bhojyam, bhakshyam, choshyam and lehyam. These are the four types of food. Bhojyam means that you actually chew in your mouth, correct? Masticate. That is called bhojyam. So the things which you have to actually chew and eat. Then bhakshyam means that which you swallow, just like that. Okay, that is called bhakshyam. You swallow many things also without actually, or you don't it tastes so bad. Mostly medicines and all we swallow. Okay, so you cannot chew it and enjoy the taste, let us say. So many things we swallow also, just like that. That's all bhakshyam. Then choshyam means you suck it. Okay, that is called, so many things like liquids we have to suck, choshyam. And lehyam means you have to lick. Again, certain things are in a gooey form, correct? Like a jelly. Even if you take it in your hand, you have to lick it. It is all sticky. So like these four types of food are there. Now all these four types of food, I am the one sitting as Vaishvanara Agni, Bhagavan says. Or even we have to say, even this nadi is nothing but a manifestation of Bhagavan. So there is a nadi called Vishwodari, which is responsible for the digestion of all your food. Okay. And then what? Pitva payasvini toyam kantastha kurute kshutam. Also there is another nadi called payasvini, which is the one which is drinking, which is sitting in your kantha, throat, and also drinks the water or all the liquids, and which is also responsible for kshutam, means you are actually sneezing, let us say, or coughing. That is called kshuta. So this nadi is the one which is responsible for sneezing and coughing, and also it is the one which is actually taking care of the, like, you feel the thirst in your throat, correct? And also you are satisfied when you drink water. All that is because of this nadi called payasvini. So Payasvini is the one which is, so whenever you drink water, this Payasvini is the one which is actually regulating your thirst and also responsible. For then there are three more nadis, okay, from the nadi chakra. They spread out, but they go down. All these nadis are going up, okay. Then there are three more nadis which are going down. What are these? Raka Shuklam Sini Vali Mutram Munjet Kuhurmalam Raka. So there is a nadi called Raka, and it actually Shuklam means, here we have to take it as some kind of a tejas. So it is actually this nadi, through that only the your tejas is going out. And then Sinivali is the nadi with because of which you can urinate, Mutram Munjet. And there is a nadi called Kuhu, and because of that only you are able to go for motion, okay, Malam. So like this, there are three nadis: Raka, Sinivali and Kuhu. So these are the three ones, three nadis which are responsible for Shuklam, Mutram and Malam. Munjet. Okay. Then what? Bhuktan Narasamadaya Shankhini Dhamani Punaha. So Bhuktan Rasam means the taste. Also you have to enjoy, correct? Bhuktan Rasam. It actually there are two nadis called Shankhini and Dhamani. They are the ones which are actually, once the food is digested also, the essence of that, it is carried by these nadis, Shankhini and Dhamani. And what happens? Kapala Kuharam Gatva Murdhni Sanchinute Sudham. And then it goes up to your kapala. Kuharam means some kind of a cavity. So in your head, inside the skull, there is some cavity. Up to that, these nadis go. Okay, they take this, all the nutrition of the digested food. They go up to the cavity in your head. And then they, Sudham Sanchinute. So Sudham here means, they are the one which is, they are actually manifesting Amrita, we have to take. Okay. So like this, there are two more nadis, Shankhini and Dhamani. So like this, then finally what? Shatam cha yeka cha nadyaha, shatam chaika na, shatam chaika cha nadyaha, syusta samyeka shirogata. So, like this, 101 nadis are there. Shatam cha yeka cha nadyaha syuhu. So, there are 101 nadis. All the things he is not naming, but he has named important ones related to your indriyas. Okay, both jnana indriya and karma indriya. And amongst all of them, one only goes up to the head. Yeka shirogata. Now, this is actually from the Kathopanishad. See, there is a Kathopanishad verse which is talking about the same thing. Shatam chaika cha hridayasya nadyastha sam murdhanam abhinisritaika tayordhvam ayannamritam amritatvam yeti vishvan anya utkramane bhavanti. Like this, there is a Kathopanishad verse. So what does it say? There are 101 nadis. Among them, only one goes up to your shiras, or the right up to this Brahmarandhra. That is the Sushumna nadi. And if you are prana leaves your body through the sushumna, means what? Tayordvam ayan muktaha, means you attain this prana is attaining, or it goes up through the sushumna, through the brahmarandra, means then the Upanishad itself says you will attain mukti, means you will go to brahmaloka. This is the krama mukti. Then from there you will attain mukti like this. See, that is why many times when sadhus attain samadhi also, they will break a coconut on the head and make it appear that prana has left through that top of the skull. For all others, the prana doesn't leave through the top of the skull. Through the sushumna, it leaves from other places. It escapes out. And then they have to undergo, they are all samsaris only. Okay. So for all others, anyaha, the Vishwak, it says, the Upanishad, means essentially it is different lokas you have to go through. You are still a samsari only. Otherwise, you go to Brahmaloka. If your prana leaves through this Sushumna Nadi and goes right up, and through the Sahasrara, it leaves up through the Brahmarandra, then you are a Mukta. Okay, like this. Like this what? Like this Sureshvara is not saying. Okay. This is being said by the Vedanta itself. Katopanishad is there. Exactly that same verse only is quoting here. The Shatam Cha Eka, like this only it says. The Katopanishad. So, Tayordhvam Ayan Muktaha Syaditi Vedanta Shasanam. The Vedanta is saying, Katopanishad is saying this about these nadis. So that's why he has picked up all these things from Katopanishad only. And yada buddhigataih punyaihi preritendriya margataha. So now he is explaining how the knowledge takes place. So when the buddhi, okay, which is impelled by again your own punya and all that, punya papa, punyaihi prerita, means which is impelled by this punya papa, and it goes through indriya margataha, through the indriyas, shabdadin vishayan bhumte. So only your mind only, along with through the indriyas, impelled by papa punya, is actually consuming all its objects, whatever the indriya vishaya. Each sense has its own sense objects. Those are all consumed. Shabdadin vishayan, shabda, etc. Bhumte. Okay, bhumte means consumes. Tada jagaritam bhavet. So when the mind, buddhi, is active, and all your indriyas are also active, and the mind, through the mind, and again the mind is going along through the nadis and all that. The indriyas and the mind, they travel out and they actually consume the objects, the sense objects. At that time, that is the jagaritam bhavet, means it is the waking world. In the waking world, all these things are active. There are objects, your mind is there, and your indriyas are also active. So mind goes through that. But when the indriyas are resolved, samhriteshu indriyeshu yeshu jagrat samskara janpuman manasan vishayan bhunte svapnavastha tada bhavet. So when the indriyas are resolved, but the jagrat samskaras are still there, whatever impressions, the memories which you have gained from already interacting with objects in the waking world, those impressions are there, and only because from that impression, mind alone is active. Indriyas are all resolved, and mind is projecting that all this vishaya. So the projection of the mind only you are now consuming. So manasan vishayan bhunte, then it is called svapnavastha tada bhave. So mind is projecting an entire dream world. based on the impressions which you have gained during the during your waking state, and that is called swapna, dream. And manasopi upasamharaha sushuptihi iti kathyate. When mind also is resolved, mind also is gone, then sushupti, that is the deep sleep. Like these three states are there, then what happens? We'll see next week. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.